Good morning and welcome to worship as we gather as the body of Christ. You through that are so tough to bear the cold, here we are. Let us stand and sing the first song.
Okay, good morning. So we're starting with a new song called Running to the Light. There's a chorus that I want you to learn with me. It's called, so it goes like this. You're the lamp, you're the light, you're the cloud that guides me. You're the way, you're the truth, you're the life inside me. You conquered my fears, so I leave it all behind. I'm running to the light. Okay, so don't worry, it's not about like running to death or don't worry, it means running to Jesus, running to the light, running to hope. Okay, I know it could have a weird context if you're thinking that way. So let's look at it again. I want you to sing it with me before we go through the whole song. All right, ready? Ready? Two.
You're the lamp, you're the light, you're the cloud that guides me.
Rest, rest.
You're the way, you're the truth, you're the life inside me. You conquered my fears, so I leave it all behind. I'm running to the light.
Let's get a clap going. We're gonna start from the beginning. Father, you are the light today. You are the light in our lives every day. You are the beginning and the end. We thank you for this connection that we can feel when we come into your house of worship through music, through prayer, through each other. That energy sustains us and gives us life. So we run toward that, and we know that that will carry us through. God, during this new year, we ask that you awaken our spirits to new possibilities, to new ways that we can revive our spirits and work for you. Keep our ears open and our hearts awake to those opportunities to serve you, to lend a hand, to be a friend. And God, we just come before you, we kneel before you, we give our sorrows to you, and we continue to worship, knowing that we are your children and that you love us so much, and we thank you and we give you so much gratitude. In your name we pray. Amen. Let's sing Child of Love.
In the
The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all. Let us greet one another in the sign of peace. All right, kids are already coming up. You may be seated, and kids, now is your time for the kids' message.
May the Lord bless you.
May the Lord bless you.
May the Lord keep you.
May the Lord keep you.
Make his face to shine.
Make his face to shine.
Shine upon you.
Shine upon you.
May the Lord bless you. Face to shine,
make his face to shine,
shine upon you,
shine upon you.
May the Lord bless you,
may the Lord bless you,
may the Lord keep you,
may the Lord keep you.
We were rocking it out at my house to this song. My boys love this song. Yes, yes, it just represents all of this to them. So good. So I am so excited to see you here today, and you brave the cold. Does anyone have a snowman in their yard or a snow person? Yes. Awesome. How about sledding? Did anyone go sledding?
A mountain on my bush.
A mountain on your bush.
The bush is like the table.
Does anyone have a Quincy in your backyard? Forming a Quincy. They want to sleep in it tomorrow night. I don't think so. Yeah.
Wait, what's a Quincy?
Quincy. It's like a whole big pile of snow, and then you dig out the middle, and then supposedly you can sleep in it.
Oh, my goodness.
Okay. Sledding today. Oh, my goodness. Well, cool. Well, I was wondering if any of you have ever seen this. Hello. Maybe I'm... No batteries. Here we go. Okay. Yes, it's a labyrinth. Yeah. I don't know if anyone has ever walked the path of a labyrinth. I know. It looks a little bit like a maze. Do you guys know what a maze is? Yeah. Have you ever been in like the corn maze at Go-Birds around the fall time? You know what I'm talking about. Okay. But it's not a maze, because when you're in a maze, you get lost. You get stuck, right? In a... Yes. And so it... You don't get lost. Well, so the point of a maze is to get you lost, but the point of a labyrinth is to become found, because you're in prayer with God when you walk the labyrinth. You're in meditation. You're thinking about God, okay? So I was wondering if we should go on a labyrinth walk today. Do you guys want to do that with me? Okay, okay. Well, so there's this great word that great song that Megan is going to play called Thy Word. I don't know if you know it by Amy Grant, but it's Thy Word is a lamp unto my feet with the prayer walk, and a light unto my path. So we need a light. So maybe on our prayer labyrinth walk, you all want to grab a light, turn it on. You can take two if you want. Turn it on, and then we'll walk our prayer today. Yeah, got it? Okay. Everybody all set? There we go. Got to hear him in a lot of, there we goes. Okay. Are you guys ready? Can you follow me? Okay, let's go on our prayer walk. Can meditate, think about God.
Thy word is a lamp unto my feet and a light unto my path.
Adults in the room, if you know it, you can sing it with me.
Still you're there right beside me.
Okay, let that be our prayer for today. Thanks for coming up. Thanks for walking the prayer labyrinth. Yeah, you can go to Sunday school. Thank you, and grapple.
May the Lord bless you.
May the Lord keep you.
May the Lord keep you.
Make his face to shine.
Make his face to shine.
Shine upon you.
Shine upon you.
May the Lord bless you. Face to shine,
make his face to shine,
shine upon you,
shine upon you.
May the Lord bless you,
may the Lord bless you,
may the Lord keep you,
may the Lord keep you,
make his face to shine.
Let's pray for the reading of the word. I will not forget your love for me, and yet my heart forever is wandering. Jesus, be my guide and hold me to your side, and I will love you to the end. Thy word is a lamp unto my feet and a light unto my path. God, may these words fill our hearts with inspiration and a solid foundation for our lives. In your name we pray. Amen.
The reading is in Genesis chapter 41, verse 46 through 57. Joseph was 30 years old when he entered the service of Pharaoh, king of Egypt. And Joseph went out from the presence of Pharaoh and went through all the land of Egypt. During the seven plenteous years, the earth produced abundantly. He gathered up all the food of the 7 years when there was plenty in the land of Egypt and stored up the food in cities. He stored it up in every city, the food from the fields around it. So Joseph stored up grain in such abundance, like the sand of sea, that he stopped measuring it. It was beyond measure. Before the years of famine came, Joseph had two sons, whom Asenath, daughter of Potipharah, priest of On, bore to him. Joseph named the firstborn Manasseh. For he said, God has made me forget all my hardship and all my father's house. The second he named Ephraim, for God has made me fruitful in the land of my misfortunes. The 7 years of plenty that prevailed in the land of Egypt came to an end. And the 7 years of famine began to come, just as Joseph had said. There was famine in every country, but throughout the land of Egypt there was bread. When all the land of Egypt was famished, the people cried to Pharaoh for bread. Pharaoh said to all Egyptians, go to Joseph. What he says to you, do. And since the famine had spread all over the land, Joseph opened all the storehouses and sold to the Egyptians, for the famine was severe in the land of Egypt. Moreover, all the world came to Joseph in Egypt to buy grain, because the famine became severe throughout the world. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God. Thank you. Today we have a second reading. There's no gospel for this day. The second reading is taken from 1 Corinthians chapter 4. Think of us in this way, as servants of Christ and stewards of God's mysteries. Moreover, it is required of stewards that they be found trustworthy. But with me, it is a very small thing that I should be judged by you or by any human court. I do not even judge myself. I am not aware of anything against myself, but I am not thereby acquitted. It is the Lord who judges me. Therefore, do not pronounce judgment before the time, before the Lord comes, who will bring to light the things now hidden in darkness and will disclose the purposes of the heart. Then each one will receive commendation from God. The second reading for this day. Grace and peace to you from God our Father and our Lord and Savior, Jesus the Christ. Amen. The new year has presented itself with some chilly weather and some other things. College students are going back to hit the books, see their friends, get involved with their activities. Younger students are perhaps starting new semester classes. The tiny ones are able to do things that they couldn't before, new habits that are the result of resolutions made on New Year's Eve are perhaps being tested. We wonder what 2024 will bring, which new opportunities we will face, and how we will be challenged with unforeseen happenings. But alongside these questions, we might even have the guts to ask ourselves the deeper ones. Why am I here? Where am I heading? How can I more fully live out God's will for my life? Who is God leading me to be this year? How can I be an instrument of peace, a glimmer of hope for others? Today's Bible text from 1 Corinthians sheds some light on where we're headed in our path to find these answers. Starts right off. Think of us in this way, as servants of Christ, as stewards of God's mysteries. Now, Paul is talking in that text, and he's talking to the church in Corinth, and they are arguing with each other, boasting about who they belong to, with which leader they want to align themselves. The Apostle Paul moves in to counteract those rivalries and jealousies with words that describe their leaders' identities. He names them, very simply, servants and stewards. By servants, Paul means those who assist or provide service to others. By stewards, those leaders are ones responsible for administrative matters in the Greco-Roman household. But let us notice something about Paul's description of those positions of power. Both are subordinate roles, servant leader, steward leader. And Paul's understanding indicates that the work done is in relationship to Christ and God's mysteries. Leaders who serve by pouring Christ's love out of their hearts. Leaders okay with the uncertainty of divine things and who have faith to steward God's resources anyway. So why is this important as we are entering into this new year, asking ourselves what will come this way and how we can position ourselves for greater things? Well, perhaps we must reframe our thinking about how we're going to go about this. With his simple description, Paul is saying, so simply, that all Christians are in service to another, that we exist for others. Pastor Chick Lane, in his book Embracing Stewardship, reminds us that stewards care for something that belongs to someone else. The steward can't be the owner. This so well describes our relationship to God and the stuff of this life. Lane says, you are a steward and a manager, a keeper of all that God has entrusted to your care. Okay, so maybe you've already turned me off right smack in the middle of January here at the beginning of the year. We're going to talk about money. Didn't we just get done with that nice fall stewardship campaign? What are we doing here? Of course you're thinking that. Because stewardship in the context of church for so many years brings to mind paying the bills, transferring money, right, from our personal accounts to help out the church budget. But these things have very little to do with what stewardship actually means. So here we're starting with a sermon series 4 weeks in January, going off the lectionary. That's why we don't have a gospel text today. For 4 weeks, Pastor Stefan and I, we're going to be talking about how do we become stewards of God's mysteries, servants of Christ. See, stewardship is simply how a follower of Jesus Christ faithfully travels through this life. Stewardship is the way we use the abundance that God has entrusted to our care to love God and love neighbor. Stewardship is the way that we love God and others with our whole lives. Stewardship is life-giving and life-encompassing. Stewardship, as it says in the text, is a way of life that involves accountability, faithfulness, trustworthiness. Stewardship is actually discipleship. Because living as a follower of Jesus requires not just all of my heart, but all of my assets, all of my time, all of my talents, in short, my whole life. And that's why we're talking about those meaty questions as we seek to discover where our paths are leading this year. In a sermon written by Martin Luther on this text in Corinthians, he says, "What then constitutes the mysteries of God? Simply Christ himself, that is faith, and the gospel concerning Christ." The whole gospel, he says, is far beyond the grasp of our reason and our physical sense. It is hidden to the world, mysterious. It can be apprehended only by faith. Perhaps 2024 will be your year to grow in your faith. Our family just got back from visiting with my dad and my sister's family in South Carolina. Thank you for letting us go. It was a great time away. We rested well with long walks on the beach, time spent with cousins, polar plunging in the ocean on New Year's Eve, and in the pool on New Year's Day, bike rides to see the dolphins at Breach Inlet, dinners at the long table together, good coffee, Coco running off leash. Look at how happy that dog is. She wasn't very happy going outside this morning, let me say. Kids diving into... So thank you. But while we were there, we had the opportunity to visit the new International African American Museum in downtown Charleston, right on Wharfside Street. If you are in Charleston ever, you have to go. It's so good. They did such a great job with this museum. The building hovers, as you can see, 13 feet above the historic site of Gadsden's Wharf, which is the port of arrival for nearly half of all enslaved Africans brought to North America. It is hallowed ground, and so they built it up. One of the most defining areas of the garden area outside the museum is called the Tide Tribute. The figures each represent a person who laid shackled in the bellies of ships that were once anchored just steps away in Charleston Harbor. As the tide changes, the shallow pool of water fills and empties, covering and revealing the shapes of those it honors. It was so powerful. We were all ready to go. Like, that was just the outside. And then we got to go in. It was so good. So the initial video, when you come into the museum, tells of the West African ancestral tradition of joining the church called seeking. Although this cultural and spiritual rite has not been practiced since the 1970s, learning about it made me think of our own paths as Christians and how each of us is seeking, taking account, checking in with how we're doing spiritually, assessing how far we've come, and looking to what's next in our lives of faith. The seeking journey would take young people out into the woods for prayer and reflection for days, even months at a time, and it would usually end in baptism. I love the description. It was so good. Baptism binds an individual's non-familial connection, spiritual connections to communities and mentors, creating powerful support systems. That is what we're about here as a community of faith. And often people want to do familial baptisms or private baptisms, and this is why we bring them into the community to be done here, because this is the body of support as Christian people that are going to follow them through their lives. Because in the Lutheran tradition, this is where we start our paths of faith. The Holy Spirit comes to live inside of us and begins to change us forever, so that every day can be a seeking experience for every one of us, searching for ways that we can give ourselves over to the Holy One and faithfully stewarding the resources we've been given by the Maker. Maybe it feels like a New Year's polar plunge for you to step out in your faith in this way, but God has big plans in store. Let 2024 be a spiritual revival for you. Exercise your capacity to go deep. Jump into a new opportunity, even if it feels a little scary, or if you think or, of course, know that you don't have time. We just launched our Passport for Learning for adults. We revamped the kids program, revamped other programs, and now we just did the adults. There are copies in the basket still if you didn't get a chance to pick one up in the console in the narthex. Of course, there's online and in-person opportunities available. Take a moment to look at it and see if there's something that floats your boat. But I'd like to draw your attention to just a few. So on Monday night, I'm pointing to Renee, we had 20 people on Zoom, I think you guys were on too, and all over the country, on the screen, asking the basics of the questions of faith. From California, two from Tennessee, Thornton, Illinois. She found us on the general website. Where else? Indiana, South Carolina. Oh, it was so cool. I mean, over 20 people. And there's room for more. And now you'll hear Ruben Hinojosa is in the back, and he's going to talk about financial peace and how that is going to be starting in February to help us have our finances. We can run our finances. And our finances and our debt and those things that we want to have in order aren't going to rule our lives. We'll get to say where they go. So Ruben will talk with you about that a little bit later. Maybe that can be your Lenten discipline, because it actually starts the Sunday after Ash Wednesday, which is very early this year, on Bring Your Sweetheart, Valentine's Day. Yeah. And another amazing opportunity, I don't know if anybody knows, Dr. Stephanie Blees, she has taught here before. She's a dynamic, young, very knowledgeable person, and she is gifting us with her time to come back and do a course on Luther. 4 weeks, starting next week from 10 to 11. If you have small children, they will be well cared for, and they will find it very exciting because we're going to have childcare available. So just come from 10 to 11. You actually get to be an adult for one more hour, so should be a good thing. So let us raise our expectations for ourselves, for each other, and for this body of Christ. Let us position ourselves in this 2024 as a community of faith, poised to make big impact in the places where God leads us. But this will take growth from the inside out, starting with our hearts. So the kids named it, most of you are probably familiar with the path of Labyrinth. The most famous one is in the Chartres Cathedral in France. The Labyrinth is basically a path. It invites everyone to take a pilgrimage. People who walk it emit an energy by praying and being touched by the grace of the moment. Everyone takes away something different when they walk the labyrinth pathway, but the outcome through walking mindfully and with authentic meditation is the same, that the body and soul become one. Step after step brings revelation, reconciliation, the sense of a loving presence, forgiveness that touches the most intimate fractures of personality, personal steps, so many acts of faith. The people at Chartres say it this way. Our pilgrims say Chartres obliges them to take a stand in full awareness and total freedom, to tear oneself away from daily life, to force oneself to take off, to ask oneself where one stands, to collapse there in order to know. The Shart Labyrinth is open for meditative walking each Friday between 10 a.m. and 5 p.m., from Lent until All Saints Day. The Labyrinth of Shart Cathedral is closed each year all day on Good Friday. Let's go there. That'll be fun. Take a trip. Well, okay, at least we can take a finger labyrinth walk together. So take your, this is a thing. So there are all sorts of designs. That first one is in the style of Shart. The second one is more classical in nature. And I did some digging. Finger labyrinths are actually a thing. They're designed to be portable. Rawl told me he has a finger labyrinth. Accessible. They're even good for children. So a little bit of instruction. Take the labyrinth in your hand, and you're going to be using, when you trace, your non-dominant pointer finger, because it'll allow you to focus more, because it'll be a little more challenging. While I pray, and after a few deep breaths, you can place your finger on the entrance, trace it with your finger, allow your mind to clear from extra thought, and focus solely on following the path. And then once you reach the center, take breath, and then retrace your path out of the labyrinth. So are we ready to trace the labyrinth? Let us pray. Lord, your servant, St. Augustine said, it is solved by walking, solvi dua abulando. It is solved by walking. God, we have things in our lives that need to be figured out. Situations that need solutions. But Lord, we know you. We trust that you direct our paths and set us on the road to freedom from guilt, from worry, from fear, from self-absorption. Lord, we come to you again today in this new year, looking for direction, hoping for guidance. Your mercy surrounds us, it fills us up. Show us your plan for us. Form us as servants, as stewards of what you have provided. Take us, Lord, for we are yours. Amen. Thank you.
continue now with the prayers for the family of God. When I say God of grace, we will respond with a new prayer response. It sounds like this.
Oh God, we call. Oh God, we call. From deep inside we yearn for you.
Okay. So we will do that a few times in this prayer. Okay. Let's pray. Father God, please encourage the ministry and mission of the church. Let the leaders of your church, especially our council members, be trustworthy and accountable stewards, that all its resources and outreach bring hope and healing to communities. God of grace.
Oh God, we